to another video tutorial of SS Tutorials. In my last video, I have discussed about the endomembrane system. In this video, I will discuss about the structure and function of different organelles in a cell. So let's start. So at first, I will discuss about the nucleus. This nucleus was first discovered by Robert Brown in 1831. Here it's the basic structure of nucleus, where you can see that the nucleus is covered by two membranes. One is outer membrane and another one is inner membrane. So it's a double membranous structure. And the place present between two membranes is known as perinuclear space or perinuclear space. And here is some thread-like structures inside that nucleus. These thread-like structures are known as chromatin. These chromatins help in formation of chromosomes. These chromatins helps in formation of chromosome that helps in cell division or mitosis. We will discuss about this later in our next class. So here, look at this. Here it's a nucleolus. Nucleolus is a structure. More or less spherical in structure, found inside that nucleus. It contains dense nucleoplasm. So here is the basic structure of nucleus. So these chromatins are two in type. One type of chromatin is known as euchromatin. Chromatin is two in type. One type of chromatin is known as euchromatin. And another type of chromatin is known as heterochromatin. These euchromatins are the chromatins which are not densely stained, and heterochromatins are the chromatin which is densely stained. So let's proceed. Then I will discuss about the chromosome. So the chromosomes, when we look at this structure, these are the chromatins. These chromatins gets packed together like this and forms a structure, X-like structure. This structure is known as, my diagram is not so good, but it looks like this. You can follow your books. Here the primary constriction is there. This is a structure of chromosome. So now we will discuss about this chromosome. So this chromosome, if you look at this diagram, then look at this. It has one centromere in the center. This centromere, it is known as primary constriction, and these are a satellite, and it's a secondary constriction. It's the basic structure of chromosome, and according to the position of centromere, this chromosome is divided into four classes: metacentric, submetacentric, acrocentric, and telocentric. When this centromere is on the center of this chromosome, then this type of chromosome is known as metacentric chromosome. So at the time of anaphase movement, it shows V-shaped structure. In case of submetacentric chromosome, this centromere is some distance apart from its center. It gives L-shaped structure during anaphase movement. And in case of acrocentric chromosome, this centromere is placed towards any end of these arms, chromosomal arms. So it is known as acrocentric chromosome. It gives J-shaped structure. And in this diagram, you can look at this. Last one is a telocentric chromosome, where this centromere is on the apical end of this chromosome, small extent of arm, you can see that it's a very smallest arm which is present in on here, and another is longest arm. It takes I shaped during anaphase movement. Then we will discuss about some special types of chromosome. One of these is Lambrasch chromosome. So Lambrasch chromosome, this Lambrasch chromosome is a specialized type of chromosome. Usually it is found in the oocytes of vertebrates and invertebrates. This Lambrasch chromosome, these are the large size chromosome. It's not in your syllabus in detail, so remember it, that Lambrasch chromosome is a large size chromosome. And found in oocytes of vertebrates. So, vertebrates and invertebrates also. So here the Lambrasch chromosome, it's the large size chromosome found in oocytes of vertebrates and invertebrates. Another type of chromosome is there, known as polytene chromosome. It's usually found in salivary glands, some cells of salivary gland, but it's not required because it's not in your syllabus. So now I will discuss about the mitochondria. In this structure, you can look at this. This mitochondria has two membranes. One is outer membrane. Another one is inner membrane. This outer membrane I have drawn it with blue color, and inner membrane I have drawn it with red color. These two place present between these two membrane is known as perinuclear space. This space is known as perinuclear space. And the inner membrane, look at this. This inner membrane has some foldings. These foldings are known as crista or cristae. If we magnify these foldings or this cristae, then we will find that some knob-like structures like this. These are present in the outer surface of this cristae. These are known as F0-F1 particles. These F0-F1 particles have an important role in our cell, because these F0-F1 particles allows the movement of H+. If we draw these F0-F1 particles like this, then it will allow the H+ through it and helps in production of ATP, ADP from ATP. So after the passing of H+ ion through it, it will produce ATP from ADP. Thus ADP and ADP and phosphate will join together and form ATP. So in this way, this mitochondria helps in production of ATP. So it is known as powerhouse of a cell. I'm writing it down. Mitochondria is known as powerhouse of a cell, because it produces ATP. So it's the basic characters and structure of mitochondria. Then we will proceed to next organelle. So now I will discuss about the plastid. I have drawn a diagram of plastid. Look at this diagram. This plastid is a double membranous structure like mitochondria and nucleus. It has one outer membrane and another inner membrane, and the place inside that membrane is known as stroma. in this chromat region some sac like structures are there. Look at this. These each and every sacs are known as thylakoid. And when these thylakoids are arranged one after another and forms this stalk like structure, these are known as grana. These two grana are joined by to each other by a lamellae or membrane known as stroma lamellae. These structures are known as stroma lamellae. It's the basic structure of plastic. So then I will discuss about the classification of plastids. There are three types of plastid. One is chloroplastid, another one is leucoplastid, and third one is chromoplastid. At first I will discuss about the chloroplastid. These chloroplastids are most important type of plastid in plants, because these plastids are responsible for green coloration of plants, especially chlorophyll and carotenoid pigments are there in chloroplastid. So these plant tissues become green in color and it helps to trap energy during photosynthesis. Then I will discuss about this leucoplastid. This leucoplastid is three in type: amyloplastid, elaioplastid, and aleuroplastid. Amyloplastid, it contains strata. Elaioplastid, it contains fats and oil, and aleuroplastid, it contains proteins. Then I will discuss about the chromoplastid. Plant tissues, they are different in color. Some flowers, they show the various colors. And in case of some fruits, like carrot is not a fruit, it's a modified root. So some plant parts, they show different types of colors. These different types of colorful plant tissues are formed due to the presence of this chromoplast. Yellow, reddish, orange, etc. The different types of colors are formed due to the presence of chromoplast. So next we will proceed to the next organelle. So now I will discuss about the ribosome. In here I have written down the points. The ribosomes are granular structure. It was first discovered by George Palladay in 1953. These ribosomes contains RNA or ribonucleic acid. This ribonucleic acid helps in protein synthesis. It's the important function of ribosome. If we look at that structure, then it's prokaryotic ribosome and it's eukaryotic ribosome. These ribosomes are made up of two subunits. One is small subunit, another one is large subunit. In case of eukaryotic ribosome, it is 80S in nature. So this 80S in nature, it has smaller subunit which is 40S in nature and larger subunit which is 60S in nature. For prokaryotic ribosome, it is 70S in type. So the smaller subunit is 30S in nature and larger subunit is 50S in nature. This S stands for Sedwardge unit or sedimentation coefficient. When we want to centrifuge a cellular components, then if we will set the sedimentation coefficient 30S or 70S, then we will find the total 70S ribosome after centrifugation. So I have completed this ribosome. Then I will discuss about the cytoskeleton. So now I will discuss about this cytoskeleton. So cytoskeleton is a structure that gives mechanical support to the whole cytoplasm of the cell. If you think that it's a basic structure of cell, and here it's nucleus. And here it's cytoplasm. So some structures are there which gives mechanical support to this whole scale cell like this. These structures are known as cytoskeleton. These structures, it gives mechanical support to the whole cell. This structure is known as cytoskeleton. So function of cytoskeleton is to provide mechanical support to the cell. It's the function of the cytoskeleton. So guys, thanks for watching my video till end. If you like this video, then like it and subscribe my channel to get more videos like this. If you have any doubt regarding to this topic, you can ask me that in the comment section of this YouTube video. Thank you.